But just as a start for a conversation, like how Malegaon, we are, all of us, some of us at least, are familiar with the milieu and sort of about, we know about the industry. But what was it sort of, and then there's already a film, and a very recent film actually, that's hence the sort of the comparison. But what is it that you went in to Malegaon with? Like what kind of film and what kind of imagery did you have in mind that you wanted to explore?
Frankly, we didn't go in there with anything particular in mind. Mm. I mean, it had
it's working.
We didn't have anything in particular in mind. It was actually originally a commissioned film where, I mean, the brief, so to speak, was to make a film on the cinema industry in Malegaon. That was the broad brief. Mm. And we were meant to go in there and look for what we wanted to kind of make a film on. So this was not actually the kind of film where we had already heard of Asif before, or, you know, we wanted to specifically make a film. I mean, the film was actually, I mean, Asif was actually very serendipitous in the process of doing our research and speaking to a lot of people there in Malegaon. Now, having said that, I think, we're all kind of, all of us are aware of Malegaon through cinema, through a lot of writing, I think, as well, on Malegaon as well. So I think the idea was to kind of add to that imagination of Malegaon in a certain way without, you know, in a sense, repeating things that we've already seen, you know. So I think that it was a kind of, it was there at the back of our minds, of course. So I mean, our impulse was, how can we shift the lens a little bit, you know, and maybe take a look at the more, you know, the relationship between people who are making the cinema and the craft of cinema itself. You know, I think the whole interiority, so to speak, of the whole process of working on a film. So that was the kind of broad impulse that we had at the back of our heads when we went in there. So,
in a way, it's a very restrained film. Like in the sense that I'm sure that there would have been things which could come across as sort of more, which would give like sort of like a quicker and like sort of an easy statement on things and certain aspects of Malegaon itself, like the loom industry, yet the dying and the struggling almost loom industry, and then sort of the film industry, which is also like kind of struggling, I mean, with budgets like 30,000 rupees, 20,000 rupees people are making. So there could be a certain obviousness. For me, what I like the fact that it is so understated and the and coupled with sort of this Asif's like almost schizophrenic like thing, even in terms of his characters. So there's this, the Janya and the whatever, 3-4 avatars he has. And then of course his life outside the acting, which we only imagine through the landscape of Malegaon, which for me like really works well. But coming back to like a question, like this film, like what, and particularly to Amit, because he's like sort of, and you also, in terms of like, when you talk about the lens, it is a almost like a style, but for this, was it like a conscious decision? Because when you go, it takes 2-3 days to say, okay, how are we going to shoot? What is this, what is the language that I'm trying to sort of evolve, the visual language for the film? So how did that come about to this? Because all your visuals look the same. I mean, it's not, so there is a particular style to it.
I think the, again, the broad thing somewhere was to kind of, you know, kind of try and excavate the silences that actually lie within this landscape, you know, in the sense, I mean, I can just quote a conversation we had with many people actually while we were researching the film, you know, the whole idea of being in a loom and what is then the idea of cinema then vis-a-vis, you know, working in the loom, you know. Mm. So they would always give us this answer key that, you know, that we work in the loom for 8-9 hours. We are constantly surrounded by sound, you know, so there's no conversation which is actually kind of possible within the loom space. So that's a space where we're constantly imagining. Mm. So I don't know. I mean, I think this was something that was there, which kind of became a kind of a, not a credo, so to speak, when we were shooting the film, but it kind of was always there at the back of our minds, you know, that there is, I mean, it's a very reflective space. The whole process of creating cinema is actually happening in a very, you know, through a very reflective process, you know. And I think while we were shooting it, that was the kind of invisible kind of, you know, again, impulse which was kind of driving us to kind of look for the spaces of silence and introspection and therefore a very
quiet, you know, restrained kind of camera, because we didn't want to kind of go in there and try and, you know, break down what it is that they were actually thinking. You know, it was more at the, we wanted it to be at deliberately at the level of suggestion, at the level of, you know, creating certain associations, thoughts, and things like that. So I think that kind of
like this morning we were having, sorry, yeah.
No, but just adding to what Amit is saying, actually, it was also interesting in the sense that when we first went to shoot, we shot a lot of the loom and everything in the loom, in a sense, because it's also, it was a very fascinating space, and we'd never seen a space like that, in a sense. So you're also responding much more spontaneously. But having spent long hours in a space like that, the loom also has a very interesting rhythm to itself. And I'm particularly in the sense that, like we were saying in the morning, we're talking, it's also the sound in the loom, and I'm not romanticizing it, but literally it is a certain, there is a certain rhythm that it sort of, you know, plays. And it kind of draws you in, it sucks you in. So as we went for the second one, you know, the second shoot, and were clearer as to why we were looking at the loom space in a certain way, it also became a way of excavating it in a particular way visually, you know. And that's why I think a lot of framing is the way that it is.
And like, I mean, just to give an example, I don't know if you answered your question about the camera and the films. You know, when we were shooting the looms, we would spend long hours, deliberately spend very long hours. I mean, 2 hours, 3 hours, you would deliberately spend inside the same loom, because I think at some point we realize that you have to kind of, you know, internalize the repetitiveness of that entire, you know, the rhythm of that space before you are actually able to find that image, you know. So there were these strange moments of realization when we were shooting even within the loom that, I don't know, it's a very, you know, subconscious thing somewhere that you feel, okay, that this is now, you know, okay, you're getting that, you're being able to capture what is actually there in your head, you know, because.
There is, I mean, if I may just add, Asif's framing is completely different. Asif was never sort of, and you're very clear about that as well. Asif was looking at a performer, really, not breaking down the performance.
Yeah.
But
it's
sort
like
of,
you're watching a performance,
yeah,
like you're watching
really
a play,
like
you're watching a movie,
exactly.
You know, it was that kind of position of the camera that we deliberately chose.
Yeah. Basically, it's like, I don't know, there are many reasons for why it is. One very, obvious thing was the fact that comedy is a huge genre in Malegaon, and Chaplin therefore is a very revered figure. Everybody sort of talks about making comedies, and that's what Malegaon films are essentially. They're comedy films. Then is a relationship that people have with Chaplin, in the sense that, including Asif, I mean, you know, they always sort of look up to him as a certain character, all of that. And third, most importantly, was also our interpretation of Malegaon, in the sense that when we were looking for a story, and we knew that we were not going to go there and document things in a certain way, you know, this would be going to at least try and, like he, Amit said, try and enter this entire thing of performance cinema slightly from another way, try and sort of shift our point of view. Modern Times was an immediate connection that constantly sort of kept coming to mind, simply because you see there's work, there's industry, there's a relationship of man and the machine, so to speak. But also formally, the form of the film, the fact that a lot of Malegaon films, people call them spoofs. I don't think they're spoofs, you know. But another thing that constantly people would say, that hum ek khancha lete hain aur fir hum unpe rang bharte hain. So this whole idea of, you know, the Malegaon films themselves work on the idea of taking an original idea, so to speak, and articulating it in their own fashion. So also then this idea of, okay, if you take a Chaplin, take a film like Modern Times, and actually, as you may have realized, Asif and all, I mean, the entire crew, their crew, they're all filmmakers themselves. So a lot of the ideas in that sense have, and we're also, you know, so the interaction is very different. You're not just working, you're not just, I mean, it's very different, you know, you're working with another set of practitioners in a sense. So therefore the idea of Chaplin, Malegaon in a certain kind of form, I think all of these somewhere informed it, sometimes subconsciously, sometimes consciously.
It's partly been asked and partly been answered, but I'll ask anyway. One, the fact that whether it's spoof or not, it's a very, very exaggerated and overstated and loud form of filmmaking. Then your choice to underplay that, you know, it's like underexposing an overexposed image. So it's something which is very loud, whereas you guys keep everything very, very subdued and very reflective in a manner of speaking. And the other thing, this entire process of working with Asif on Chaplin, did you guys workshop with him? What was that contraption that you guys invented, you know, which he used? They invented. Yeah, so actually that's two questions. So, you know, like you to talk.
I think, again, I mean, like coming back to what you said in the beginning, yeah, that we deliberately wanted to take a very distant position somewhere and allow, you know, I don't know whether it comes through in the film, but allow natural spaces for Asif's natural sense of performance to be the kind of high points, so to speak, you know, while we were editing the film. You know, I mean, that's primarily what was kind of the, what we had kind of intended when we wanted to do that, you know. So we had a lot of conversations in terms of maybe how we would want to do it, how we would like to shoot it. And that's how I think a lot of the sequences also kind of came about, you know, that this was a kind of natural thing that, you know, they would kind of do it with some of their films, he would do it with some of his films, he wouldn't, you know, like the idea of doing a rehearsal, for example, is not something which completely comes naturally to all their films.
Not even to Asif at all.
Yeah, so in that sense it was, again, it was also that, you know, the whole relationship between film, it was actually an engagement between two filmmakers, so to speak. So they were actually very clear that, okay, it's your film, you all decide how you want it to be done, which is not in terms of a, you know, that you all tell us what to do, not in that sense, but let's sit and talk about it together and let's, but, you know, finally you all decide that, you know, okay, this is maybe how you all want to shoot, how you all want to frame, where you all want to shoot, that kind of thing.
But having said that, Mukul, it's also interesting that in the sense that I'm just reflecting on what you're saying and going back to some of those times, there are two, three things that happened at least while shooting with Asif and the rest of the gang. The fact that, okay, very clearly, and when you're saying understating, overstating, I'm also going back to that. Yeah, end of the day, they were very clear that this is your image. But the way that image is going to come to you, because they're also, you know, they also are image makers themselves. So they're also very aware of that. So a lot of performance, like the what Amit is calling rehearsal spaces, I sometimes actually now in retrospect wonder whether they're rehearsal spaces at all. Because the relationship at that point in time, even though the camera may be static, but Asif is actually constantly interacting with it and playing with it, now I'm thinking in my head, in his own way, because he's very aware of the way that his image is being created. So I think it was a bit complicated in that sense, and I'd like to think about it a little more in that way.
Just taking off from what both of you are saying, and I'm just like talking from the top of my head, like, but just the thing, like Asif as a character, for instance, he is what he chooses to present himself to you.
Absolutely.
In a way. But so in this film, it's actually very apparent that, okay, this is a performance, this is an actor, and this much is what he is disclosing to you.
Yeah.
And the rest about Malegaon industry, you have to produce through your own understanding, your own time, your own research, your own sort of, whatever, your own aesthetics. And sort of then it's making me think of other sort of documentary practice and documentary work where there is no acknowledged actor. Okay, but the person is there, people are there, and people are giving interviews, and they choose to give this much. And somehow as filmmakers, very often, what happens is that is sort of taken as just a given. As if it is like the complete whole picture. There is very often no introspection on the part of the filmmaker that, or to somehow bring in the fact that this could be a performance or a kind of, and performance I don't mean pejoratively at all, I mean a performance. Like even if I'm sitting or you are sitting here in front of like 50 people, we are automatically in a performative mode. So I find that interesting actually, more for other films to and I don't know, for me also to think about that when somebody is performing for the camera, then as a filmmaker, how do I sort of work around that and to understand that aspect?
Absolutely.
So this film, in that way becomes kind of
interesting that you're saying that because, and this was the initial days when we began to shoot with Asif and all. You know, initially, the first 5 days, it was actually a bit frustrating as well because they would constantly keep, in their head, the idea of a documentary was, you tell us what to do and we will do it. And so actually it was not something that, and we knew that we were not going to do that.
Mm.
But till you sort of came to, certain things happened and came to a point, and it was only when a breakdown happened in all of us, like in them and in us, that I think the film actually began to happen in our heads.
Yeah.
And so that in itself was a very interesting process of, you know, shooting with people who are very aware, in a sense, even in terms of their craft, as to what is done and, you know, how you sort of present yourself.
Yeah. I can continue. Is there a question? Does anyone have a question or a comment? Yeah, exactly.
People are so used to action and cut. Even while shooting documentary. Arey, wo to ho gaya, nikal gaya, par wo camera roll nahi ho raha tha, to chhoot gaya, chalo.
But no, the thing also that to think about is that certain forms that have always been there, but not sort of acknowledged. In a way, also, there are more people who are making films, all kinds of films, who are involved in all kinds of, like, whatever, image-making practices. That I guess, and there are more forums to kind of talk about and to reflect on our work also. That so that is not to say that certain things have not been in the process for the last 20, 30 years. But okay, that caveat aside. But the thing that somehow there are some kind of forms which lie outside fiction and non-fiction. So in a way, like this film, there are parts of it which are actually fiction. I mean, in the sense that this person is performing. So when I am seeing Janya, or when I'm seeing, I keep forgetting Jethani. All the other names, Jethani, then I'm seeing a fiction performance. Yeah. And I may be seeing a documentation of it, or a video of it. I won't even call it a documentation. And then, of course, there is this other strand, which is kind of like, documentary-ish, where the loom is the character. So, in fact, the loom is the more documentary character, in a way, than Asif is, because the loom is allowing you to, is giving you more freedom, actually, to be interpreted in the way that you choose to, than Asif is.
Absolutely.
So, that is something that I've, it's kind of interesting and taking off from last night and this morning breakfast. But a little bit more, if you want to speak about, say, like, because we see the industry as this particular, which is also the sort of the alternate Malegaon industry in a way, and then there is this larger mainstream Malegaon industry. So what is the, and mainstream again in quotes, but what is the relationship, and it's very like curious question, but what is the relationship between the two, sort of these two worlds? Do they interact, or it's like ki hum alag hai aur wo alag?
It's actually very fractured. I mean, it's almost like Bombay, come to think of it. You know, it's almost like, you know, like many like production houses, not in terms of the aesthetic so much, but in terms of, okay, this is the film that we are making.
Mera actor hai, mera producer, my camera.
Mera group. So there are like lots of groups like that, you know, which kind of work and thing. Now, what drew us actually to Asif, he has a very interesting history as a performer.
Yeah,
at some point in the 90s, he started off as a mimic artist who would produce these audio cassettes. I mean, there's a bit in the film where you see that Hansa audio cassette, Zulia. That's actually a short excerpt from one of his audio stories that he used to take, where he had actually created these characters, Janya, Jethani, and he has two, three other characters. And then he kind of took these same characters to the stage, so, you know, as a live performer. And then once, video came in, you know, then he transposed exactly these same characters onto film, in a sense. So, I mean, that was actually, frankly, what drew us towards him, because we had not seen anybody else like him in Malegaon as well. I mean, Malegaon, yeah, it is, you're right. I mean, it is 90% of it is the way in which we traditionally understand Malegaon cinema, you know, as taking films from Bollywood and making spoofs in quotes. But with him, it was kind of interesting because he was actually one of the few, again in quotes, original, so to speak, artists that we found there.
We'll have to wrap this up, and I'm sure you can take other questions and comments in the lunch.